Hello everyone and fellow polymaths, I'm Michael Rocky. We are here at the Southern Oregon University for the Creativity Conference, second year of this conference. And I'm here with a very special guest, Irina Trofimova from McMaster University, very accomplished researcher. So Irina, could you talk a little bit about your model of temperament and how it relates to polymathy?
Sure. It's two questions, actually. It's not so much temperament. I was interested in multidisciplinary analysis of behavioral regulation. And the idea is that temperament is probably the best concept to reflect on how individual differences emerge in behavior. Mm-hmm. Because we are all walking and talking chemical factories. And behavior regulated by chemistry much more than by structures. So if you want to know the individual differences, we better see what neurochemistry does, what psychopharmacology does in terms of fixing behavioral deviations. Right. In psychiatry, as you know, we fix behavioral deviations, behavioral differences using drugs, using chemical components and not by neuroanatomic interventions.
This is very different from the American tradition of using the Big Five and other personality approach, right?
Yes, see, Big Five is not biologically based model, mm-hmm. It's a lexical model. You know, they studied social perception, how people perceive each other, and that's how lexical approach started, how models of personality started, and then they started claiming that they identified biologically based traits, which is not true, they didn't. They first came with a model, and then they came to neuroscience, to biologists, asking them, could you please find the biomarkers? And of course, you can't find the biomarkers because it's a very mixed model. It's mixing social factors of behavioral regulations, biological, and intelligence and temperament. They take everything with everything and blend it in one go. The point is the concept of temperament. And that's where brilliance of Hippocrates was. He said, yes, brain structures are major organs to regulate the behavior. But when it comes to individual differences, it's no devil in details, basically. It's in neurochemistry. We are talking about neurochemistry such as neurotransmitters, hormones, opioid receptor systems, neuropeptides, but also other chemical parties such as immune system and guts, basically microbiota in our guts. So many factors we had to analyze, and I'm really grateful to the giants of the neurochemistry, like Petra Natter, who inspired me to go this way, to see how neurotransmitters contribute to temperament traits. And of course, I read the publications Trevor Robbins and Barry Everett, mm-hmm. on differential functionality of neurotransmitters. And that really was in line with a model that at that point we already developed. It was really helpful. My model was based first on the study of my graduate supervisor, Vladimir Rusalov, with 12 components. And I decided just to verify it with neurochemistry. Mm-hmm. So when I went to verify it with neurochemistry, I read Trevor Robbins' paper on neurotransmitters and so, wow, this is in line what we just tried to show.
And you talked about Rusalov, but his lineage goes to Alexander Luria and even Pavlov, right?
Well, yes, Alexander Luria was a brilliant, brilliant neuropsychologist, and he really was rooted in science. Mm-hmm. And Rusalov had background in anthropology. And that's what clicked with Luria. So Luria invited him to be his student. And I'm a graduate student of Rusalov, so it kind of makes me academic granddaughter of Luria. But interestingly enough, the models that now we employ came back to whatever Luria suggested. Mm-hmm. Because Rusalov's model has four columns with three rows, and Luria suggested three systems, not four. And when we started editing it and started verifying it against the functionality of monoamine systems and opioid receptor systems, Luria's system, the three-column system, lined much better than Rusalov's system. So I switched to Luria.
Can you explain a little bit about how the model works, the functional ensemble of temperament?
Yes. So How it works, there is no one-to-one correspondence between one trait and one neurotransmitter system or one neurochemical system. These systems work in ensemble. Mm-hmm. However, they don't play in ensemble all the music every single time, all instruments. Mm-hmm. For specific aspects of behavior, some neurochemical systems are leading and some are submissive. And following the Luria lead, we identified a convergence in many neurosciences and kinesiology and also psychophysiology on three functional aspects of behavior, such as expansion of behavioral alternatives, a choice of alternatives, and energetic maintenance of chosen program. So these are dynamical aspects. Mm-hmm. And what we found that the functionality of monoamine systems and even opioid receptor systems line up very nicely with the three groups. Mm-hmm. Such as noradrenaline is expanding the alternatives in many ways. Dopaminergic system prioritizing alternatives, helping programming behavior or putting the motor programs together. And serotonin or acetylcholine systems, they're helping maintain certain behavior, such as attention or physical endurance, etc. So under the lead of the systems, other systems cooperate with the leader, mm-hmm. but there is very logical distribution of labor in this neurochemical ensemble. And of course, there are several families of neurochemical systems, such as monoamines, hormones, neuropeptides, and opioid receptor systems. And it's funny how they lined up in these four rows mm-hmm. of our model, leading each row. For example, social interactions, it seems like hormonal systems have more to say in social interactions than in physical capacities or in mental traits.
So you came to a model where we have three different columns, where we have a leading neurochemistry. The first column would regard to the behavioral orientation, mm-hmm. and then we have another system for integration of actions, for tempo, and another column for actions that we do the continuation, the endurance of actions. Can you explain how those columns are related to each other?
Right. It's an ensemble. All 12 aspects are present in every task, literally. Mm-hmm. However, some tasks require more orientation, some tasks require more integration, some tasks require more maintenance. Some tasks have more social aspects than physical. However, even if you do physical interactions, your position requires your posture, requires physical maintenance as well. And even when you communicate, you use motor systems to generate the language. So all 12 aspects play. However, in each situation, the demands for these aspects are different. If you have a task where you have to maintain some activity, for example, right now you're maintaining attention, mm-hmm. it's maintenance. You have to maintain position, it's mm-hmm. maintenance. At this point, you already integrated the program of actions. Mm-hmm. In terms of physical activities or mental activities, etc., you know what you're doing, you just need to stay with the program, right? So your leading system becomes a maintenance system. However, I finish my reply to your question, and you need to generate another question. Mm-hmm. This is the integration of new action, right? That's why the dopaminergic system is very important, because while you're listening, you try to integrate the next question, and that's how there is a transfer from maintenance system to integration system.
Right.
However, if it's not working well, for example, oh mama, I don't know what to ask next time, etc., you need to go for extra alternatives.
All right.
And that's where you go back to orientation system all the way there and saying, guys, I need an alternative, what else I can ask, etc., etc. And you expand your alternatives. If your integration system finds something interesting, say, yeah, this is good enough, yeah, I can ask about this one, it goes back to integration and then to composing this action, and then you are going to maintain this intention while it's kind of
right.
Relevant.
So it's a dynamic system?
Absolutely. It's passing back and forth, back and forth, back and forth.
And what could you say about when we have to reprogram our actions? You said just a little bit, but could you speak a little bit more when we make plans and the plans do not work and we have to reprogram our actions? What would be in place?
That's right. For example, you wanted to ask something, but then you realize that, oh, it's probably not appropriate. And then you need to reprogram it. You go to orientation, expanding the alternatives. However, there are sometimes cases when people simply can't perform. They just, they're not into routine things. And that's what they do. They're constantly reprogramming. And interesting part is that when you're reprogramming, you're not thinking into details about every single aspect of reprogramming. You're putting together the bricks or the units of behaviors that you already developed before.
Mm-hmm.
So kind of automatic elements. And the ease of the integration of these elements, we call it tempo.
Mm-hmm.
For example, how fast you talk. You don't learn how to talk now, right? You learned it before. You're just using these little bricks to compose the sentence. The same thing with the physical activities, etc. And the same thing with mental activities. So when we are doing so-called reprogramming, many times it's just combinatorics between the elements that we already learned before. It's not so much into creativity in a sense that what this conference is about, but it is in the sense what Bernstein suggested about like 80 years ago. Bernstein was the father of kinesiology,
mm-hmm.
and he proved with his experiments, with his tracing devices, that every single behavior, every single act is a construction. It's basically putting the program together in construction. The difference only is in complexity.
Okay.
Right? But we are constructing behavior, and we are constructing it on several levels of behavioral regulation. Some level is automatic, we are still constructing, but it's automatic level of construction. It goes well under the consciousness. Then it's subconscious level, when we kind of monitor what's happening, but we don't pay too much attention. And a very, very small percentage of our activities of behavior is monitored by consciousness. Very small percentage,
right.
You know, the estimate's like 7%.
Can you talk a little bit more about that? We live in a very big, noisy world, so how can we make sense of the world and how different people and individual differences play a role on that?
That's true. And that's where individual differences in intelligence, for example, come, and in performance. All 12 components can contribute to the outcome, what the type will be. But let's say one person has more brain power, more cortical resources. So when they're composing their behavior, they are composing the reference to all kind of range of contexts. To social context, to wider context of the community, to much wider context of the country, national identity, or to the whole universe or the world or whatever planet, it doesn't matter, ecological considerations, etc., etc. This contributes to his decision-making and finally putting together a program of actions. Other people might have less capacity to comprehend this context. We call it concrete thinkers or concrete information processing. It's easy for them to process here and now what's happening or just recent memories. But abstract concepts, they don't have it. Sometimes they don't have it because they were not exposed to formal education. And it's very important to expose a child to formal education to develop this abstract knowledge about the world, about the nature, about the rules, etc.
There is a window of opportunity, so that would be good to add exposure to the person.
Yes. Of course, the earlier you start, the better.
Mm-hmm.
You have to expose the kid to behavioral alternatives. You have to supervise the kid to avoid danger situations, but other than that, let the kids explore. Let them go around the kitchen cabinets, open it up, try to do this. However, during the exploration, it's very important to exercise the discipline.
Mm-hmm.
Saying you took something, you put it back. So it's not only exploration of what I can reach, but exploration, what kind of settings, what kind of inhibitions society gives me, mm-hmm. and how the world is operating. It's a very important to have this teaching or nurturing of the kid with introduction of the rules and introduction of the possibilities around the world.
Okay, so we could associate exploration to the first column, the noradrenaline system, mm-hmm. but of course it should be moderated by other systems. Okay, so we go to the polymathy question right now, mm-hmm. And we know that polymathic people, they explore, they have breadth, they have range, but they also have profoundness, they have depth. They are able to engage in a task, to complete projects, and to understand things with depth. And of course, uniting all this power, they can generate good new options, sometimes novel, surprising options, that we call creativity. So how could you make this connection about polymathic people and the different polymathic types with your model?
I think polymathy comes when we have five traits explicitly highlighted. Less controversial traits are, of course, ability for probabilistic thinking. This relates to ability of people, they refer to different contexts, assign this probability of events, such as how common the event is, how rare it is, what the causes and sequences of the events are, and have some kind of probabilistic maps, mm-hmm. what to expect. Usually people do it on their own and they learn from experts, but they develop their own vision. These people kind of trust their judgments much more than somebody else's wishes. So they're not easily manipulated. They have their own mind, as we say, which is good. So you can actually negotiate with them.
Some people call it developing good theories of how things work,
exactly.
or how life works.
Exactly. Their own probabilistic theories, what to expect next. The other trait is plasticity. Plasticity is a common trait in any creativity. And this trait is ability to switch between one course of actions to another in changing situations, and it's basically adaptivity, how adaptive you are. This is a very cortical trait. It was linked to dopamine GABA networks in the cortex, and it's well studied actually by many methods in neurophysiology.
All right.
The other trait is sustained attention. We call it mental endurance. It's ability to complete the task. Mm-hmm. And that often is missing in descriptions of polymaths people. Everybody is saying of polymaths, it's about expansion of how many things they tried and how many things they achieved. But it's very important to remember that, as you, for example, pointed out, people can try and abandon some projects. And polymaths didn't abandon it. Polymaths actually continued expanding their interest there and continuing to be prominent. Yeah. In it. Good examples are Leonardo da Vinci or Mikhail Lomonosov in Russia. And they really succeeded. They actually proposed some theories, they proposed some ideas. They kept their attention on the task, and it's probably due to frontal acetylcholine systems. Acetylcholine system is really interesting thing. It's not only frontal systems, but also forebrain systems, which are kind of under the cortex. This link between subcortical structures and cortical structures helps to coordinate the action, because most of attention is subconscious.
So accomplished polymaths, mm-hmm. they have a repertoire of actions, mm-hmm. but before that, they must have had attention, paid attention to really acquire and finish the projects. So they acquired the repertoire, and when they are exposed to the world, so they can see which kind of actions could work. And with their dopaminergic systems, if they make a plan and it fails, which is so natural in life, they have their repertoire and they can go back to the exploration system to try a new program. So that would be a good explanation of how a polymath operates in the world?
Yeah. It's very important to remember that all these processes, they go kind of simultaneously, not exactly in the sequence. It's semi-sequence. But while polymaths decide to explore one subject, the other subject still continues on the back of his or her mind. That's why it's so much integration. Mm-hmm. And they do benefit from the crossing between projects. But if we apply this our division on disciplines, yeah, the projects belong to different disciplines. So it's not about division of the subjects, it's about the depths, as you say as well.
The division comes from society. In their heads, exactly, yeah. There might be no division, yeah, right? Yeah.
But they do have this ability to compose new product, some new idea, and maybe even invention or some kind of, I don't know, discovery, etc. Or a song, or repairing the cars, for example, something hands-on. But the mind doesn't stop from orienting. Catecholamine system, dopamine and noradrenaline, it's the same mm-hmm. family. They exchange their notes. In fact, there are studies showing that these receptors share the same resource. Basically, you have DOPA, which is breaking down to dopamine, and it goes to the noradrenaline. But there are some several neurochemical systems that can slow it down or speed it up. Mm-hmm. So for one type of people, this breakup goes fast, so they're more noradrenergic. For another type, it's quite opposite. You have this dopamine still holding on, but it doesn't rush to break up all the way to the noradrenaline. So you have less noradrenaline and more DOPA and more dopamine, and right?
So what's the implication to the behavior of these two kinds of people?
Right. Then implications are if you have artistic person and noradrenaline, it's also a hormone very much entangled with stress hormones and with kappa opioid receptors, which are in turn linked to chronic anxiety. Mm-hmm. So many artists are chronically anxious, and it's not a surprise. Besides, art comes with this simultaneous perception of information, which is the key sort of feature of right hemisphere of the brain, is that it's exactly where we have high density of noradrenergic fibers in comparison to left hemisphere. These people literally have more noradrenergic regulations and dopaminergic regulation, and that's why they may be more emotional. It's not just anxious, they're literally more emotional, they're more dramatic. But dopaminergic fibers are more present in left hemisphere, mm-hmm. and dopaminergic system helps to integrate the tasks.
And integrate a sequence of programs of action
that might work. Yes, yes. So, and it's regulated by mu-opioid receptors, which are approving actions, giving the sense of security, giving the sense of positive emotionality, we call it. And they are rivals with kappa. So mu and kappa, they're kind of reciprocal systems inhibiting each other. If we have stronger dopaminergic system and stronger mu-opioid receptor system controlling the release of dopamine, then we have creative person who is secure, who is optimistic, who is hopeful. Parents around think, oh, you're doing nonsense, who cares? And he keeps going. He keeps going, or she. And this is the signature of dopaminergic people, basically people who don't mind trying this, trying that. If we would have anxious people, they would say, oh, it was a shame, I shouldn't go there, it's such a disaster, etc. Dopaminergic person doesn't care. Dopaminergic person saying, oh, well, I tried, let's try again, let's try something else. And they go.
Can you talk a little bit about the initiation of action mm-hmm. and the prioritizing of actions? So which systems are at work when you feel the urge to initiate mm-hmm. and when you plan your sequence of actions?
Mm-hmm. Okay, yes. Initiation of action, you know, delta opioid receptors, they were studied in the context of opioid addictions and pain management. But now more and more studies show that they actually regulate impulsivity. If you manipulate the system with special binding agents, rats might be more impulsive or less impulsive. It seems like this is your initiation of the action. And these delta opioid receptors regulate the dopamine release. Prioritization of the actions is also important. It's an assignment of the salience of importance of events. This goes first, this goes second, this goes last. And this sequencing probably is done by cortical systems. The dopamine is present in several layers of our brain. It is involved in different ways of generation of our behavior. For example, there are very strong systems in striatum that control our generation of the action again, including semi-prioritization, what goes first, what goes last, but on the very basic level.
All right.
When we don't need to sort out through probabilities, it's not complex context, but in a special fit of integration, that's what striatal networks are.
We could say that the delta opioid system push the action, and then it goes to the dopaminergic system to do the all this planning and prioritizing, right?
Right.
Okay, in our research, Angela Cotalesa has interviewed some very accomplished polymaths, and we also have anecdotal evidence of, in the beginning of life, polymathic people, they are all into expansion, and they are sometimes misguided or misdiagnosed, and then after some time, they change. So what could you tell us about that? About this phenomenon?
Mm-hmm. Yes, when we have young kids, it's a challenge to identify the polymaths as different from kids with ADHD, because polymaths people, due to their high cortical capacities, comprehend the task and they comprehend the message from the teacher very fast. Mm-hmm. They learn very fast. So by the time teacher finished explaining the material to everybody else, they already got it. Mm-hmm. Okay, they don't need repetition. Or sometimes they look at the teacher and see that, nah, she's not super competent. Why should I care? I know better, right? Because they already had the homework and studied something. They start behaving as if they would have ADHD. They would show symptoms of hyperactivity. For example, they start moving around and kind of think, oh God, you see the constant activity, physical activity, because the dopaminergic system is active, mm-hmm. and it puts together physical integration of behavior. They start kidding the students in the room, start exchanging notes, they start grabbing things, because their physical integration is as active as mental integration. The integration of the action is fast. So before the teacher finish asking questions, they already know the answer. Why should they wait? Oh, yeah, I know. And they start interrupting it, right?
Oh, okay,
it's
so at a superficial look, if a person sees a polymathic child, he may think that the child has attention disorder, but in fact, it's totally different, right?
Exactly. And it's very sad that we allow teachers or even doctors or psychologists put the labels to children before the brain has a chance to mature, and worse, give the medications to children, compromising children's brain, basically chemical systems, when brain is still maturing. It's already well known, well documented, that impulse control is regulated by our frontal lobes, and frontal lobes are maturing till the age of like 23, 24, and yet I see parents giving drugs, Ritalin and other cognitive enhancing drugs, to children as young as age 6. Mm-hmm. And it's terrible because they're compromising the ability of their brain to mature. Okay, it makes a kid a little bit zombie-like, not impulsive. It's very convenient to the parent.
And however, to society.
And to the society, totally. But we are ruining somebody else's life.
Yeah.
I think it should be illegal mostly. I mean, science shows, why don't we respect science? But I think it's all this lobby from pharma industry who would like us to purchase their products. And it's terrible.
That's a very, very serious topic. And it's like everybody knows that the prefrontal cortex is the last area to be developed. It's not like one person thinks like that. It's total consensus. And in fact, each person develops in their own pace. And anyway, at 6, everybody agrees that there is no single person in the world who has a prefrontal cortex that is developed. Very, very important point here. Let's go back a little bit to the attention. You were talking about the basis of attention, that it's not only conscientious, so That's a very interesting idea. Could you go back to that?
That's right. So mental endurance, we call it sustained attention. It's regulated by acetylcholine systems, but also by, in a part, noradrenaline system, to identify what's novel and what's already known. So the novelties should be on the back of the mind. That's why noradrenaline system will link to attention as well. So you have a combination of attentional aspects. Acetylcholine provides tonic attention, sustained one, and noradrenaline provides attention to novelty. But with polymaths, if it's so much resources are in cortical systems, then very often the striatal systems are under-resourced. It means they have a harder time to execute tasks which require automatic behavior, which requires repetitive behavior, routine behavior. It's very hard for them to do some kind of constant digging in the ground or, you know, working on conveyor, fixing the cars or something like this. So
there is a trade-off.
And that's where the difficulties might be in their lives. So in angel studies, she heard that so many people with polymathic, I hope, abilities struggled in their career, keep schools, and they're getting out of the society. So maybe they, because they didn't want to keep the job that requires simple routine things. And they called it, I didn't fit in.
Yeah.
But yeah, you, honey, didn't do the job properly. But problem is, you are slightly different individuality.
Mm-hmm.
So I can hear that bosses yell at this polymath saying, you know, you didn't do this, you didn't do this, how come you didn't do that? Because a polymath person, instead of completing the task, which is routine task, prescribed algorithmic task,
cannot engage their attention in any sense.
Yeah, it can, but if there is a choice of exploration, for example, they're supposed to do some prescribed routine, but meanwhile, there is something that they didn't know before. They can't resist going there, wasting very valuable time. And they think, oh, it's routine thing, I will do it fast. They will not do it fast because their striatum is underperformed. They will do it sluggishly. So they underestimate the time, but they learn something that's very interesting for them.
And especially when they are younger, it's going to be difficult.
Absolutely.
And especially to get to this planning, when, oh, I'll do it fast. It's not mature enough to...
But paradox is that even when they're older, even when they know the consequences, even they go, they know I need to feed the family, I need to get the job, I need to do something routine, okay. So they go, they get the job and in theory qualified, but at the job they underperform. If it's something repetitive, there is no novelty, they will underperform, they will skip it or something.
Yeah, it's a matter if there are other things in the world that I can't resist. Why am I forced to be doing such an algorithm task? And perhaps that's another important argument for how polymathic people might be better in the future, since these algorithm tasks are being replaced by robots.
Exactly, so exactly. Why don't we replace the algorithmic tasks by robots, and then we'll have more freedom for polymath
that's
people
a good
to create
opportunity.
Something,
yeah,
to sure. generate something.
We hope that it happens this way. There is one more very important aspect, that the physical and the bodily aspect is very much overlooked in mm-hmm. the psychological literature, mm-hmm. even in creativity, mm-hmm. and your model has a whole role for that. Could you tell more about these relationships of mm-hmm. motor and intelligence mm-hmm. and polymathy mm-hmm. and how it is interconnected?
It's funny that polymaths wouldn't be much different from the community in terms of physical and social verbal aspects. It means they could come in any flavors mm-hmm. and there wouldn't be a specific signature of the polymaths. Their signatures will be in cortical traits that are regulated by like neocortex. And another signature relates to delta and mu opioid receptor systems. With delta, it's initiation of actions, but also mu opioid receptor system, which is sense of approval, security, satisfactions with the choices. And this is interesting because that's what helped polymaths to survive all the adversity that they faced. Just picture the polymath's life. From the very birth, they can't follow the crowd.
Mm-hmm.
They're constantly lonely in a way. They're breaking the walls They're knocking the doors that didn't expect them to be knocked in. They're being pushed around, saying, la, 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 what do you do? Okay, you didn't complete this. How dare you go there and there? For example, Leonardo da Vinci was, of course, a polymath, and I just completed an excellent workshop in British Library on his work. He didn't finish much of the projects, but it's okay. It's like some things he actually finished. But funny part is he was criticized by Michelangelo, because at that point, both of them studied muscles, but Michelangelo studied and was just good enough level. Leonardo went all the way to everything, to the vessels, to the nerves, to the brain structures, etc., which didn't have much to do with appearance. Mm-hmm. And Michelangelo started just enough to show the appearance a little bit. And then Leonardo went all the way to study geography, really into very much details, how to earth construct it, underground water, how the mountains being built. And I remember in this workshop, one geologist from UK, and I remember his reaction. He said, wow, this is a theory that now it's a standard theory in geology, but I didn't know that Leonardo already invented it at that time. Because we thought it invented in the last century, mm-hmm. but actually he framed it out. Now, he was criticized by Michelangelo. Why do you need this geography things, landscapes, to draw the landscape? It's good enough to kind of see the weather, etc. So that's basically the life of polymaths. They're being criticized by their colleagues, they're misunderstood sometimes, and they have to face enormous novelty everywhere. And they're just fine. Why is it just fine? Because they have this mu opioid receptor system securing them. Mm-hmm. They don't care about approval. They have the internal approval with them all the time.
Perfect.
They don't care about uncertainty, and the uncertainty can come with negative circumstances. They're just fine. They know they will survive somehow. And that's what basically life for Leonardo. He was very young to go to Florence, started working completely orphan, basically life. He led the orphan life. He didn't have much social support from the family. And then to Milan, completely different things. It's the capital at that point of Italian art life. He has to show off he's a nobody, he's nobody's son. Mm-hmm. Remember, he was a legitimate son. Mm-hmm. You need to have a lot of mu opioid receptor system, kind of, a lot of endorphins to feel secure. So that's basically five traits, but in creativity traits, slightly different. With polymath, it's the top three cortical traits. For creativity, you don't need to have all three top. You only need to have plasticity, but also probably a good striatal system for these bricks of behavior, or let's say units of behavior, such as tempo. Mm-hmm. It's either physical or social, or both, or whatever. Creative people, the dopaminergic system quite active from the very early age, and by adulthood, they already tried many things. Mm-hmm. And if they tried, meaning in the striatum, they already have these units of behavior that they can put together, so they can generate a new program much faster.
All right.
But this is creative people, not so much programmers. No.
There is one more trait I would like to discuss, which is neuroticism, mm-hmm. and how polymathic people deal with uncertainty and having their plans crushed. So could you talk about that?
Yes, the beauty about opioid receptor systems is that we do generate the agents that binding to these systems inside our bodies. Mm-hmm. We don't need to inject stuff or consume some kind of, I think, or smoke something to activate it. We have our own endorphins generated first by guts in our bowels and in our brains. They're binding to this opioid receptor, mu opioid receptor systems. We have dynorphins, again generated all over the brain, binding to kappa opioid receptor systems. As I said, mu mm-hmm. opioid receptor systems are rivals with kappa mm-hmm. opioid receptor system, which is a very rough kind of approximation linked to generalized anxiety or chronic anxiety. So what's happening, they are suppressing each other. If you have mu upregulated, or not upregulated, if you have mu much stronger activated, then kappa can't get out much. It can sometimes, but in most of cases it can't. Normal physiological reaction to stress to rejection is stress hormone system and kappa opioid receptor system in linked to the system, but they were not implicated in acute anxiety, in acute stress. They only implicated in chronic stress. So you can have stress hormones kicking you out, saying, oh, I got rejections, or public humiliation, like sometimes Leonardo had it. There is a normal reaction to abnormal circumstances, and individual differences come in how long this reaction is going to last.
All right.
Mm-hmm. And how long it's going to last depends on what neurochemical horses systems are involved, what ensemble is playing.
Yeah.
So you have rejection, you have or anxiety, you have really uncertainty when you go to some other city, you have anxious thought. In polymath situation, if you have very strong production of endorphins, so all receptors fed up and all receptors are fine. So you don't have hungry receptors. So Kappa tries to say, look, we really have anxiety here, we really have to worry about it, but your mu opioid receptor system recover from the stress much faster.
Mm-hmm.
It binds the endorphins and dopamine says, ah, I know what to do. If this doesn't work, I'm going to do this. If this doesn't work, I'm going to do that. Perfect. And so they have programs.
Goes back to the connection to the dopaminergic system.
Exactly. In other alternative types, if you have not polymath, but a neurotic person, for example, artist with a strong density of noradrenaline fibers or neurons, then literally you just mention something and this activation of the stress hormones coming to the blood go poison and poison and poison and poison.
This is a very, very important question, and that's a finding also by Angelo Cotalesis, that polymaths sometimes feel this imposter syndrome. When they expand, they are like go into somebody else's territory, the specialist territory, well defended, and if you are not a specialist, you were not supposed to be there in their territory. So that's a very important thing to be developed by polymaths. Do you think that with more exposure to this kind of uncertainty, polymaths end up getting better and better in dealing with the situation? Instead of going to a different city, we'll go to a different domain that's populated by other specialists. Do you think that as time goes by, they become more accomplished in surviving in this different...
Mm-hmm. Okay, now imposter syndrome is interesting. It's sort of a common conception thing. If you have this imposter syndrome, you are anxious and you are paralyzed from anxiety and you hesitate of doing the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
But the life of real polymath is like this. Okay, the more I learn, the more I know how much I don't know. They went to the field and other people didn't go to that field. So other people, because they know less, they're more confident. They know enough. The more people know, the less confident they are. They simply aware how much they don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But because their mu opioid receptor system is strong, they don't mind it. They don't mind this insecurity. They feel like they don't know. You can call it imposter syndrome. It's, oh God, I don't know this, I don't know that. Sometimes I wonder. This is natural. This is normal reaction to the circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
You come to the field, you don't know, and you are aware of it. They're smart enough, they're really smart enough to see the limitations. They honestly admit, and they don't mind this admission.
Mm-hmm.
Incompetent person will hide it.
Yeah.
They don't mind it, and they really like to work with reality. So that's basically the realist. Right?
So do you think that a polymath's worldview is like, you are here, you have this immense territory, and while some people go into this immense territory and just like put a hut in a single place and just disregard other things, I would like a more picturesque description of how a polymathic person views different areas to explore. Why some people just disregard some areas and polymathic people say, I should really explore this as well. So how could you answer that?
Well, I think it's all in cortical capacities, brain capacities, let's say, resources. Mm-hmm. It's neurochemical resources, and they are the main lead in what you're going to want and what you're going to do. We have individual differences in terms of how neurons are distributed through the brain. Some people have very strong striatum, so they're excellent workers on doing routine jobs. Mm-hmm. But they're not so much abstract thinkers or mathematicians, quantum physicists, but we need them.
No judgment of value.
Exactly. But polymaths feel that they have this high density of cortical resources. They don't recognize that they're different. They sometimes don't understand why people don't like what they like. They don't make a big deal out of their capacities, follow the rules. They observe the rules. They start getting a map of what's happening around them. They start making decisions. If their parents are not exactly polymaths, in some point in life, they understand that parents don't get it. Parents kind of not the best advisors, so they pass parents and move on. What they do, from my observations, are that they really pay attention to sources of information, to the experts, to good teachers, competent teachers, very attentively. They really can filter who can teach them more, or what can teach them more, like internet or something like this. So very often they're not into socialization, because crowd behavior is averaging the intelligence, and they want to feed the intelligence. So very often they're kind of loners, and that's what Carl Jung described, mm-hmm. introverts. He said this type of introverts, orientation to knowledge, internal processing of the information, behaviorally looks like they socialize less, because they orient their behavior based on their internal programs instead of external programs. And he called extroverts people who orient their behavior by opinions or by kicks from other people. Mm-hmm. It's a different concept of extroversion and introversion.
Yeah, than we have today.
Yeah, polymaths are looking for resources to simplify the maps of the reality, mm-hmm. and the maps of the information. If you have a polymath with a high sensitivity to colors and perhaps a high ability to put together a dimensional object, then you can have an artist polymath, mm-hmm. plus a scientist like Leonardo da Vinci. Mm-hmm. He went to painting, to whatever arrangement, but he also studied sciences. I know people who are very good doctors. They went to medicine. But on top of that, they played putting together some sort of models, really created toy cars and models, or houses, or collecting some item, really huge collections of specific items. So they went to the completely unrelated fields of the interest, and I truly believe their choice dependent on the capacities of their brain to process information in this specific modality. Mm-hmm. Or some scientists become musicians. Again, it's auditory modalities they have special gifts for. So basically you have very different distribution of capacities, and this capacity scream, please play with me. And people, not just, can call polymaths a lot of people actually, people go and they explore according to the screams, according to the demands of the capacity. Some people stay on the task, especially if they have supportive environment. And some people just give up because, you know, no time.
Sure.
I think it's just a matter of abilities of people to explore in their life.
Right. So we could say that we have those
exclamation points, screaming, and they are almost irresistible, and then we end up exploring the world, mm-hmm. According to them. And to wrap up, polymath is a complex phenomenon. I think sometimes it's difficult to understand polymathy because it involves expansion, but it also involves filtering, and it involves breadth, but also depth in the capacity to integrate and generate new things. Would you like to have a, a final statement or mm-hmm.
Well, you're actually right, because see, even if polymaths are really wide, have wide interest, they have to filter 99.9% alternatives. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to complete it, and life is too short. So it's all about filtering. What polymaths learn, that's why they really listen to the experts very carefully. Even Leonardo da Vinci, he was a personal friend of many scientists.
Mm-hmm.
He abandoned other sources of information and filtered the experts. And that's what smart people know how to do well.
Mm-hmm.
They differentiate between experts and just speakers.
They're looking for quality,
they
for
want the
substance
quality.
Of
right,
information.
Right. They want this core information. And the more they learn, the more they're able to filter.
Perfect.
Then they become more efficient in choosing sources of information.
We could say that their ultimate project is to have a better and better theory and image and experience of life in which they increasingly refine with increasingly better information. We could say that's a polymath's final project, right?
Exactly, exactly. And polymaths, the more they know, the more they're picking. And that's what helps them to filter better science.
Yeah, right? So it's not about knowing everything or wanting everything or looking at everything. It's about choosing many projects, not one,
yes, probably
many, but many projects that will be meaningful and help understand life itself. All right?
Probably, yeah.
Okay, very good. Thank you, Irina.
Thank you, Mike. Nice
very
talking
nice
to you.
Talk.
Yeah,
my
nice talking to
pleasure
you.
To be here. Thank you, everyone. That's a Polymath's Life. I'm Michael Waraki. Bye-bye.
Bye. Wow, that's very good.